been Back to the Future at the movies. Now go there on your NES. In Back to the Future 2 and 3, a double mission to save the future. LJN's Back to the Future 2 and 3. Get it while there's still time.
To the future is my favorite thing. Always talk about it and write songs to sing. Even though there was never a part four, Marchy McFly is coming back for more. I don't make money, get no fame. Love for these characters is what I blame. Podcast about comics and cartoons and more, 'cause there's still things to explore in Marchy McFly 4. It's Marchy McFly 4. Can you feel it?
It's Thursday, March 21st, which means it's the 21st day of the fourth year of Marchy McFly. And today, I'm here not talking about the animated series. No. I'm here doing a twofer. Two for the price of one. Double the flavor, double the fun. Double the discussion, but neither thing we're doing is the animated series. Folks, we're doing two things. We're talking comic books. We're talking video games. First up, I'm going back to the Future, Untold Tales, and Alternate Timelines comic to read the final story in this collection. After that, we're going back to the Nintendo Entertainment System to talk about Back to the Future 2 and 3. It's one game based on two movies that came out 1 year after the original game. Can this game be better than the last one? Could it possibly be worse? I don't know. I'm looking forward to playing it. Hopefully, I'm going to try to make a video element out of it as well, even though this episode is not going to be on video fully because you're not seeing me right now. Let's be honest, most of you aren't hearing me right now. But all of you are hearing me. Because if you're hearing me, you're part of the group that is hearing me. I'm using logic right now. Logic, yes, that's what keeps me going. So let's not waste any more time, because tonight also I'm on my other podcast, and I'm probably going to mention this many times, and I'm saying this because I might happen to be recording this out of order, but I'm recording with another podcast, my buddies Chris and Dave will be doing our other podcast, Fine Movies, Fine Spirits. We'll be talking about the finest movie, one of the greatest films of all time, Back to the Future. Have you heard of it? Yes, yes, yes. Well, I'm here to not talk about movies, not talk about cartoons, and not yet talk about video games. I'm here to talk about comic books. And let's go to the fifth and final story in this tale, this collection. Every issue has had two stories in it. Every single issue, except this last one. This is the final tale of Back to the Future's Untold Tales and Alternate Timelines. This is Clara's story. Clara's story the story is by John Barber and Bob Gale. The script is by John Barber and Eric Burnham. Art by Marcello Ferreira, and colors by Diego Rodriguez. The cover art, which we see here, which is pretty cool, is by Dan Schoenig with colors by Luis Antonio Delgado. The cover of this story is wonderful. It is Doc and Clara running away from a bunch of flying DeLoreans. They're on horseback. They look frightened. They're running away, and it's pretty spectacular. But let's see if this comes into play with the story we're about to see. So it picks up in 1885, June 12th, 1893. So it has been 8 years since Doc has seen Marty. For Marty, it'll go by like a blink, but it's been 8 long years since Doc has seen his friend. No wonder he's excited to see him when he does. I really like the art so far, just in this first drawing. They look to be on the train, and wait a minute, if they're 8, so Jules has to be 7, I would guess. I mean, you never know. Maybe it was maybe Clara couldn't wear white to the wedding. So they're on the train, and Doc says, this is it, boys. Everything your old man worked for comes down to one moment. You ready, Clara? She says, more than I have ever been, Emmett. But. So they're on the track. She says, have you laid sufficient track? Last time you required far more distance to get up to speed. Good question, Clara. It was a day I expected to be one of the highlights of my life. And we know this is Clara's story, so I'm assuming this is Clara talking. So she says that, and then Emmett says, but I've refined the Presto logs we used to get Marty back to his time. And these tracks are aligned with a railway that will be built in the 1950s. Still in use in 1985, where we'll pick up Einstein. Okay. Doesn't your doggy miss you? He says, from his point of view, I've only been gone just a few hours. Plus, he's used to my eccentricities. At any rate, once we have Einstein on board, we're not going to need tracks. Well, oh, wait a minute. Where we're going, we won't need tracks. Ooh, I love that line. Where we're going, we won't need tracks. Well, we will need them, but we won't have them. So we'll figure out a way to not need them. And he's holding the hoverboard. Interesting. Clara goes, Emmett, please, no more delays. I'm ready to travel. He says, just so. The future awaits. Now, outside the train, there's people watching. They're like, what's Doc doing, Pa? I assure you that doctor has a plan, son. That's, wait a minute. That's Sheriff, Strickland. So he's still alive in this storyline. Thank goodness. However, I haven't the foggiest what it might be. Hang on tight. The train is about to take off. This is about to get serious. Now we're in Clara's thoughts. She said, I feel I must have paused here and take a moment to explain my feelings at that moment. Yeah, that's what it says. For it occurs to me that while you, do I sound like Mary Steenburgen? So that it occurs to me that while you may not know my actions in this saga, you know little of the woman partaking in them. Oh, you may well know my actions in this saga. You know little of the woman partaking in them. And then we jump back to October 25th, 1855. You know little of the woman partaking in them. I said that already. So if you'll pardon this digression, I was born in New Jersey, the daughter of Martha and Daniel Clayton. Now, we met them in that animated episode, Clara's Parents. They know this. When this story was written, the cartoon already, years had gone by, so they can take right from that. I'm yawning because I'm tired. Even though this episode went up early, I'm time traveling. Yes. He met my mother, a rough frontierswoman, while on a butterfly expedition in the Western Territories. He did have butterflies, I think, on his wagon, so I think this sticks, this holds. It was love at first sight, this meeting of opposites. I'm told I took after my mother, which was, of this, I'm sure, a challenge. I believe my escapades convinced my parents that one child was more than enough. So it shows Clara as a young woman, like, climbing the side of her house, She says, but I found a sense of purpose when I was 11 after contracting diphtheria. In retrospect, I was lucky to survive the disease, even though I didn't feel lucky until my father brought the gift that opened up the world. And there we see the telescope that, remember, her father bought her a telescope. She talked about it in her love of science. Science! She said, to this day, I know not if he meant the telescope to be an object of observation, of observing children at play, to draw me closer to them. Wait a minute. What did she say? To this day, I know not if he meant the telescope to be an object of observing children at play, to draw me closer to them. Oh, I see. So, I don't know. This kid's outside playing, but she's just looking out her window with her telescope. She said, I feel certain he did not expect me to forego sleep in favor of stargazing. The world on... Can I do a Mary Steenburgen? The world on the sky of out of place has previously unknown to me. No, I cannot. Shocking. It was a frontier uncrossed, and I found the implicit possibilities intoxicating. I learned I was not alone in my consideration of the promise of the cosmic ether, and she's reading books now. I found a deep kinship with a man many years my senior. Oh, I know, his name is Doc Brown. One whom I never met nor spoke to me, but to whose words spoke to me. Jules Verne. Jules Verne's ideas lifted my heart and, more important, inflamed my mind. Yeah, we knew she loved Jules Verne to the point where it drew her closer to Doc, and she said, yes, I'll name both my kids after him. I eagerly awaited each new release from Monsieur Verne, a practice I still maintain. It was warming, meaningful. She's ripping open a book, and you see, like, women, you know, she's like out in town, and there's a woman with a male suitor, but there's Claire just sitting alone on a bench reading. Someone understood me. Meanwhile, the children around me grew and offered me little interest. Of course, I offered little to them. What an interesting story. This has nothing to do with time travel. It's just filling in the gaps of Clara. I like this because Bob Gale is behind the story, so I'm taking this as canon. I believe then, as I do now, that people should tell the truth. Yet so much of what passes as relationship with others has its foundation in half-truths or outright lies. Lies of politeness or propriety or society. I think I said those right. My mother trying to fit in with a civilized that tamed her wild nature understood. Fathers attempted to introduce me to young men from good families, but these never lasted long or ended satisfactorily. So it shows her at her dinner table with her parents talking to, I guess, people, a suitor. She's trying to read around the world in 80 days, but the guy doesn't care less, so she doesn't care less. It thus came to no surprise to anyone that I became a school teacher. The unmarried lifestyle endemic to the profession suited me, and young minds were so open to possibilities. So teachers didn't marry then? Interesting. Truthful and imaginative, much like Jules Verne or myself. So she has little kids in the class. One girl's drawing her on the herself on the moon, so she probably gravitates to this girl. My father died in 1879. And my mother 5 years later. So neither of them get to meet Emmett. Well, unless you count the cartoon. My parents left me a modest sum of money, a house in New Jersey, and the worst qualities forged between them. From my father, I gained meekness and introspection. From my mother, I inherited a disregard and convention unbecoming of my gender. Okay. One night, I saw the future. I was alone, surrounded by a book. Books in an empty house. Ghosts walked the corridors, not the spirits of the departed, instead phantasms of a life left unlived. And she's envisioning herself as a cowgirl, as an explorer, as a, I was going to say astronaut, but this is the 1870s, as a deep water diver, I guess. All the things that Jules Verne talked about. I awoke with a start and a single thought. Go west. Wasn't that the band? Go west.
I'm over you. I pretend my ship's not singing. And I tell myself I'm over you because I'm the king of wishful thinking.
I'm sorry. Once I started, I couldn't stop. So I did go west, hearing of the teaching job in Hill Valley, California. As far from the civilization of the East Coast as one could find these United States, what I hope to discover, I know not. A new frontier, as the stars above had promised. Love, as my parents found on the Oregon Trail. I found both, but not as I expected. Emmett Brown was a man out of time, a man from a world I had only dreamt of. Initially, I did not believe him, of course, but by the time Emmett helped his friend Marty return to the future from whence he came, I knew I had found a kindred soul, one whose thirst for knowledge equaled exceeded my own. And it shows her arriving on a train with Indians, Native Americans on horseback nearby. It shows the shot of her and Emmett meeting for the first time after he saved her, the train pushing the DeLorean, and Clara being saved by Doc on the hoverboard. He said, and I hasten to add, he was a hero. He understood my feelings of isolation, of being born in the wrong time. In Hill Valley, decades before he would be born, Emmett finally fit in. His vocation as a blacksmith provided for us and allowed his time to enjoy his scientific pursuits. And Emmett was happy. So it shows Emmett in town just enjoying life, you know, making horseshoes. He gladly relinquished that drive that had once spurred him. I wondered, had I been born in his era, would his interests have been encouraged by society? Would my interests have been covered by society? So it shows her in a very 80s look, with a car that doesn't really look like a DeLorean. I don't know if it's supposed to be the DeLorean. It is. It looks like the time machine, but it doesn't look like a DeLorean. Weird. He said, would I have become a time traveler like Emmett? And now she's talking to him on the porch one day. Are you truly content? He's like, what? Here with me. Is this what you want for life? Of course, Clara. I've never been happier. But don't you miss the universe? All the space and the time was once your domain. All of space and time was once your domain. And now, it's not all fun and adventure. Something happened, didn't it? Tell me the story, Emmett. Okay, now we're going to a story within a story. This is Inception. He says, it's not a tale for the faint of heart, but perhaps you should hear it. Oh, he tells the story of Back to the Future 1 and 2. When I built the time machine, it was to witness not only where mankind had been, but where we were going, to help understand the greatest of unknowns, to see the future. When I finally got there, I stumbled onto a boy's mistake, the far-reaching consequences of which ultimately destroy a family of my closest friend. It shows 2015. It shows the USA Today, even though it says US Now in the comic book version. Youth jailed. He says, I know that interfering with events that had already happened could be cause for a catastrophic outcome, but I put those thoughts aside. This was the future, I told myself. It hasn't truly happened yet, which means I could fix it. Pure hubris, and I know that, but I believed I owed it to Marty, whose help I needed to implement the plan I concocted. So we see a doc show up. Marty says, what have we become, assholes? And then we see the clip of him saying, go over Cafe 80s, guy named Griff, just say no. He says, as we both know, the more variables one introduces to any given situation, the less control one has over the outcome. I had succeeded in my initial goal. Marty's son was kept from making a life-altering mistake. But in the process, the secrets of time travel and discovery was used without my knowledge. Jesus, is he really giving the history of all three movies, or the first two movies? Or at least the second movie. I guess he's not even talking about the first movie. Okay, I don't know what's going on. This is going to be interesting. This is Clara's story, remember now. And now we're in some deep, dark part. Like, I guess when it's the one story telling the whole thing, I feel like Clara's story is over, and now we're in Doc's story? Okay, I don't know. He says, when we returned to our time of origin, things weren't correct. There were buildings that had never been built, pollution that was out of control and a wanton disregard for law and order. This was not the hill valley we'd left behind. It was a hellish slum. At first, I held out the foolish hope that the DeLorean's time circuits was somehow misaligned and we wound up in a dystopian future that my actions had somehow ensured. It was the most remote of possibilities, but I had to eliminate it. So, okay. He now thinks that he is maybe in the future. So he's heading to the library. It says, look for your new BIFCO development. And it says the public library closed by order of the mayor. Now, he does talk about this, right? When he sees Marty in part two, he says, remember I went to the library, and he gets all the information that he shares with Marty back at his house. He says, I broke into the library and raided its newspaper archive. It not only effectively dispelled any illusions I may have had about being in the wrong time, it revealed that time had been changed, and Marty and I had returned to a parallel timeline, a timeline that had rewritten the destiny of the entire world. And worst of all, it shows Emmett Brown committed, Biff wins again, but he doesn't talk about, this is going to get interesting, because he says, I need a perspective. I needed to talk to someone. And in that moment, there was only one person that I could think of. Oh, my God. He says Emmett Brown's been committed. And where does he go? He goes to a hospital. The nurse says, you want to talk to Emmett Brown? I'm sorry, mister. What did you say your name was? Von Braun. I'm a distant cousin. I'm sorry, Mr. Von Braun, but that just isn't possible. He takes out a wad of cash and says, are you sure about this? Again, this is still supposed to be Clara's story, but I think we've long gone, left that behind. She goes, well, when you put it that way, you got 5 minutes. And for all the good it'll do you, this is really depressing. He goes into this padded room, and there's this man with a straitjacket on in the corner. We can't see him. We know who he is. He's veiled in darkness. And our Emmett says, hello, Emmett. I understand that this is unconventional, and I assure you that I wouldn't be doing this if it weren't for the utmost importance. I need a better understanding of the particulars of your history. It seems like the nurse is overhearing this or eavesdropping. He said, I found evidence that Biff Tannen created this alternate timeline by going back in time. That's bad enough, but what kind of damage was really done? If the newspapers are to be believed, you were committed before I completed a fully functioning version of the time vehicle. How could this world exist without time travel? Interesting, I never thought of that. He says, Biff needed knowledge from the future, or none of this could happen. Then he goes, I think it's our Biff. He says, we created a paradox. Oh God, this is the worst fear realized. The space-time continuum will eventually try to correct itself. Surely you realize this, and what is it? When it does, this version of me will be erased. The DeLorean will be wiped from existence, and all the history is affected. The decades-long divergence. Do you understand? Do you even understand what could happen? I could use you, your insight, in order to... And then he looks, and okay, this is scary and depressing. Great Scott, the man who turns and looks at him is drooling. He's completely bald, and he has a giant scar on his face. His eyes are lost and glossed over. It says they had performed a lobotomy on my other self, cut out a chunk of it, his brain, destroyed his mind, my mind. This was hell, Clara, a hell of my own making. By trying to change the future for the better, I ruined the present. Marty and I were safe for the moment, protected by a bubble of timeline we had come from. But bubbles burst. And when this one did, if it did, the world would feel the full effects of temporal feedback. And it will all come to a screaming end. Universal destruction was at the forefront of my mind as Marty and I returned to the 1950s to undo the point of divergence before it could even occur. We see the shot of Marty stealing the almanac by doing a flip over the Biff's car. He said, we succeeded. But it was clearer than ever that the time travel was simply too dangerous. The temptations to use it for one's own needs were clearly too great to resist, even for me. But before I could return to the proper time and destroy my work once and for all, fate intervened and brought me here, to my favorite era, a place where I was free from the temptations to fiddle with the stuff of the universe. I was getting a second chance in heaven, this time instead of hell. And it shows Doc as he first landed in 1885, or yeah, whatever he landed. It might have been the year before. Was it 8 months, right? Something like that. He's looking at a map and he heads into town. You know, he's dressed like Doc with a white collar, white jacket and like the train shirt, and he's heading into town. An old West that probably looks at him like, what the hell's going on here? So he says, I was in heaven instead of hell. This reality, now we're back with, in Clara's story, in the original flashback, he says, this reality with you, this is perfection. This is where I belong. She says, Emmett, I'm with child. We're to be a family. I've never seen Emmett happier than that moment. Yet, how I long to see other places, other times. But who was I to ask him to give up his reward? So it shows them reading by a fire. Clara's super pregnant now, and she's holding the hoverboard, thinking about the future. After all, we still had Jules Verne, and soon we had Jules and Verne. Now we show two boys, and Doc's reading to them. She says, I love them without reservation, and I love the stories Emmett tells them of his adventures. Yet, how I wish to join those adventures, to take the boys to the future and the past. I tried to hide my feelings, a practice I had grown accustomed to through the years. Could Emmett see through my facade? He sees her just kind of looking out the window, and he's looking like, what's troubling you? He says, Clara, come with me. I have something to show you. The life we build here, it's splendid. More than a man myself could hope to dream of. But out there, my friend Einstein, my friend Marty, as happy as I am here with you and the boys, do you want to leave us, Emmett? What? No, of course not. I want to take you. I want to take you and the boys back with me. Back to the future. He leads her out to a barn, opens it up. There's the train. He says, at least for a visit, I was the happiest I'd ever been until today. And there they are, on the train, ready to go. When Emmett hesitated yesterday, it worried me. It worried he would be pulling me from the only life I'd ever knew. I realized I had to conceal a piece of myself that I had, that I had concealed a piece of myself that I believed we shared. But from this day on, I vow this. No more secrets. It shows the train going, leaping into the air, and not making it, and just crashing right back down on the track. The sheriff and his son walk up. He's like, Doc, are you all right? Clara. And he says, I'm fine, Emmett. We're all fine. So the boys are fine. He goes, I don't understand. It isn't when it happened. Oh my goodness. It should have worked. My calculations. Everyone makes mistakes. Even the Baltimore Gun Club. What? The what? Oh, yes, of course. An asteroid threw them off course in Verne's novel Around the Moon. They never made it to the moon. Not in that novel, but I always believe they tried again. And armed with the knowledge, succeeded. I don't know, Clara. I'm sure Marty will take care of Einstein. I could stay happy here forever. She finally says, but I couldn't. I need this, Emmett. I need to see the future. This is my dream. He says, I don't understand. She said, no. He says, no, but it's not your dream. It's our dream. All our dreams, Dad. That's my Jules. And here's my Verne. You told us so much about the future. We must go see it. How do I go about this? She goes, Emmett, look. And then he says, great Scott. Someone invented cars without me? Pardon me, sir, this contraption of yours, he says, Sir Pullet steam tricycle. I had it imported at great expense from France. He goes, oh, France, yes, of course. Tell me, how fast does it go? Why, I've taken it past up to 18 miles per hour. He goes, 18. Well, that sounds, she says, that sounds like a good start. The future would come fast enough once we set our minds to it. So, okay. So the train originally just was a good old train, I guess. And now he's using steam instead of coal. I don't know. But my goodness gracious, this went long. And guess what? I'm only halfway there because this is a double episode. The rest of this collection just shows cool art and cool covers. Looks like alternate covers. And some of them look like cereal boxes and just a lot of great art that, you know, if you're a Back to the Future fan, you would love. Oh, a nice cover just had Gray's Sports Almanac. Some really great stuff. This is a spectacular collection. So I suggest if it's available, you pick it up as well. But that's it talking about the comics. That's it for part one. Let's move on and start talking about another video game. Okay, now I did say this is a double episode, which means we're getting two elements for the price of one element, which is also priced at $0. Yes, folks, I wasn't planning on doing this. And then I talked to a former and future guest of Marchy McFly, my buddy Eric. And he said, oh, did you play part two and part three? Or I brought it up and he said, oh, did you play that? I said, no. Oh, I should. And now I am. Now we're looking at the screen here that says Back to the Future 2 and 3. They decided to put out one video game for both movies, I guess because both movies came out back to back. Now you do see that it says 1989. UCS and Amblin. I assume UCS is like Universal Computers stuff. It says 1989. It didn't come out till 1990, which makes sense because part three didn't come out until 1990. It says, like, if I'm looking at the release date, it just says 1990. That's all I see on it. I don't even know what to say. It's the same people making it. Beam Software, LJN, on Wikipedia, it says Acclaim Entertainment. Acclaim are the people who, they purchased LJN. Remember, we talked about that last time. LJN made those WWF awesome figures. Video games don't seem to be their strong point, at least this video game. But, you know, the first Back to the Future was crap. Okay, it was crap. You figure, okay, they have, oh, look, published 1990. We see it there. They have to have learned their lesson. There's no way they wouldn't learn their lesson. And there's another year ahead. Now, yes, it's the same platform. It's the same Nintendo Entertainment System. But I feel like you see the games that came out like early, you know, the like 86, 87. And you see the same in 1990. There were advances in these games. They were able to figure out how to do more with the same amount of computing power. So I'm hoping that this, you know, it's a double movie. It's a double video game. Hopefully it's double the entertainment, double the fun. And I wonder if they will follow through with the like bringing the bees back. Is that going to be part of the ongoing saga of the Back to the Future video game, even though it has nothing to do with the Back to the Future movie? So let's get started with this. At least I'd like to get started. I think I'm supposed to like press A or something. Maybe I just wait. Okay, here we go. Back to the Future 2 and 3. Already the graphics look a little better. We see 2 and 3. We see a DeLorean. I mean, look, these aren't great graphics. These are something that you can make. They're like, what do they call that? 8-bit graphics. There you go. But there's something just inherently beautiful with these old-fashioned drawings and graphics. So I'm going to press start to begin like it says. I haven't heard anything. Oh, the sports almanac. In the year 2015, your arch enemy Biff, he's really, really Marty's arch enemy, I guess so, stole Doc's time traveling car and sports almanac. Is traveling with two L's? I really don't know. He then traveled to 1955 and gave the book to his younger self. Yes, we know this has happened in the movie. I guess I press A. Oh, Biff Tannen. By 1985, Biff, using the information in the sports almanac, became the most powerful and corrupt man on Earth. He's the most powerful, most corrupt man on Earth, and his big claim to fame is making a casino in Hill Valley, California, in the town he grew up in. Okay. To protect the almanac, Biff scattered objects throughout space and time and locked them behind closed doors. So like sort of like a Horcrux, I guess. The only way to defeat them is to get them all together. As a result, the space-time continuum is falling apart. Okay. Your quest, Marty. I'm Marty? Oh, good. So at least we established that it is Marty. It's not some, you know, guy fighting bees. Your quest, Marty, is to travel through time and space, find and eventually return these objects to their correct locations. The almanac will then be destroyed and the future restored. So this seems like they're taking elements from the movie and then adding a really dumb gameplay conceit to it, and then saying, and then this will then you'll be able to do what Marty did in the movie with a book of matches. I guess that's what they're saying here. So, oh, I'm reading more. Okay. You'll also need to find a remote controller, which will allow you to call the DeLorean. Okay. Let's make this more complicated. All right. Okay, now go for it. Ooh, okay, I haven't heard a thing yet. Do we have sound? Oh, now I hear it. Forget what I said. So, am I going to the right? Am I going to the left? So, for those of you listening in the audio podcast, it's Marty is dropped off. Oh, what happened? Where did it go? Did I lose the screen? No, it just went behind. Never mind. Marty is, I don't know what the hell, how to explain this. Marty has like a big cowlick. There are soda bottles floating in the air. It looks like it's a dystopian 1985. I think that's what it's supposed to be. It says Back to the Future in the bottom. 10, and then maybe a pizza. 00, I want to say a beach ball. 10 again, and a bunch of zeros. Maybe those are my points. So I'm going back and forth. I can go either way. I can press. Oh, I can jump. Jump. Okay, it's a side scroller. So that's already. There's the Biff bar. Can I go in there? I can. What the hell is this? Is this just Super Mario Brothers? Oh, hurry up. Get the pizza. And cookies, or are those baked potatoes? Get the pizza and the baked potatoes. Whoa. This is your life. Wait, do I die? Oh, I guess I just leave through the tunnel, which looks very familiar. What in the hell was that? And now I'm back outside Biff's bar. Oh, there's a floating thing. Do I touch it? Okay, I do. What in the hell is going? So now it's like a side scroller. You got to be kidding me. There are snails going by and turtles. This is a Super Mario Brothers, an awful Super Mario Brothers ripoff. Now I'm going through a door. Nope. I guess I need a key. Do I literally jump on those things like I would in Super Mario Brothers? So there's a snail. Oh, it killed me. When it killed me, and then a DeLorean comes in, flies in, drops me off. So I'm just back where I am. So I can die, and then the DeLorean allows me live, die, repeat, kind of. I'm feeling like either I'm in a time loop or Doc has cloned me and keeps going back an extra minute to get another version of me to do this, whatever I'm supposed to be doing, collecting bottles, I guess, to get the deposit. I don't know what's going on. So I'm scrolling. Oh, boy. Scrolling. I'm jumping. I'm very nervous. Oh. Is that a Hamburglar? Rubble, rubble. There's what looks like, I can only describe it for those of you listening in audio, as a hamburger with feet chasing me back and forth. I'm going to jump on it. Here goes. Wee. It just disappeared. And I don't know. Now there's a spiky turtle. I'm afraid to jump on those. But I mean, this is back. This is Mario Brothers at its worst. Okay, there's a, am I supposed to go on that? Am I supposed to avoid the raindrops? There are now raindrops and another hamburger. This is back to the, folks, I want to remind you, this video game is supposed to be Back to the Future. And I don't know what I'm doing. Is that a hoverboard? Hoverboard. Okay, I can't do anything. It's just, I can go back and forth. But that's it. Okay, I reached the end, I suppose. So what the hell am I supposed to do? Surprised they don't have me jumping up a flagpole. Okay. I guess I go back the way I came. Whoa! Or I just plummet to my death. So the DeLorean drops me off again. You know, okay, I literally was just going to die again. I remember seeing pictures. Okay, this is stupid. The DeLorean, how the hell am I supposed to get over there? Is holding down B make me run fast? Nope. The only thing that does anything is A. And I just died jumping into a turtle. Classic Back to the Future. For some reason it drops me off there. All right. Oh, I did it. Okay, I'm back. Now to the hoverboard. I'm going back this way, Muffy. I don't know why who Muffy is or why I'm talking to you that way. And I lost the hoverboard. Is there an up? I don't know what that is. It supposed to be a subway station? I'm going to press up. It looked like a dragon was about to be dropped in my head. And what the hell? I just fell. What the? So I guess that is a ledge right there. This is making Back to the Future, the original video game, look like an okay idea. Am I supposed to? Oh, nope. The Hamburglar got me. And the DeLorean drops me off again. They must be like, this young boy, he just keeps coming back and getting killed over and over. I don't know if I'm supposed to touch that or not. I'm going to keep going up. I don't know what's happening. I don't know what the point of this is. And now a fish just blew a bubble and the bubble killed me. This is Back to the Future. I want to remind you. And the DeLorean just dropped me off into my own death. This is okay. And I'm done. I don't know where to go from here. So I have to go back the way I came. There's a fish that can jump through the air. I'm collecting bottles. I'm avoiding bubbles from fish. This is rotten. Nintendo put their seal of approval on this video game and said, yes. And it dropped me off again to die. And that's it. That's game over. I am sure there are better, like, it doesn't even give me a chance to, what the hell is that? Is that a weird face? And a key. I can't get to the key. All right. I'm not playing this video game anymore. So Back to the Future 2 and 3 sucks just as bad as Back to the Future. Am I on that? Can I go in there? Nope. It's a different game. The gameplay is a little nicer. Maybe. Is that pizza? I'm supposed to collect pizza. Oh, is that Griff? Am I supposed to jump on him? I don't know what I'm supposed to do. So a dude just went by on a hoverboard. It looked kind of Griffy. Not Ken Griffy. Like Griff Tannany. So now I'm going this way. Biff, look, there's Biff's paradise. There's a I just saw a lizard. Remember the lizards in Back to the Future 2 and 3? Me neither. And Biff just, I came out of nowhere. And I don't know. So I'm going this way now. This is probably going to be it for me. I can't imagine I can do this again. I'm going to do these 9 lives that Cat's eyes using anyone and then the dead, but I'm dead. Oh, I'm back in. I'm dead. Oh, no. I'm dead again, my friend. I can't believe I want this game to end. I'm just going to keep going to the left. And I fell and died. It doesn't let you know that is not the best when the DeLorean drops you to your death right away. Oh, I'm dead. This hill valley is way worse than the one that Biff Tannen had. You know, there was some Sammy Hagar playing. There was a lot of bikers. There were Like, there was some shooting. Okay, I guess I'm done. Can I go in the pawn shop? No, I can't. What am I to do? I'm going to go back to that. I can't duck. I can only jump. This game. Is there down? I guess I'm going to go back down. I'm going to keep going this way. I think there was another. Oh, I'm dead. Oh, my God. I'm afraid to jump on that turtle. Okay, up. I'm going up again. Now what? A bat. Look out, the bat. Okay. I feel like, am I getting somewhere? Kill that bird. Die, bird. Lion Estates. Can I go home? I just want to go home. Like, they put in elements. Do you know in Super Mario Brothers 2? If you ever look at Super Mario Brothers 2, it is so different from Super Mario Brothers 1 or 3. Because, and now I can't, what the hell is the point of this game? What am I collecting? Am I supposed to, they don't even tell you to look for something. Oh my God, this game is, I guess I'm supposed to go to the right. This is the worst thing. So Super Mario Brothers 3 looks very much, very different from every other Super Mario Brothers game because it wasn't supposed to be a Mario Brothers game. They just slapped Mario and Luigi on there and said, okay, now it's a Mario Brothers game. If you look it up. There's another game. I think it was in Japan or Korea. I'm not sure exactly. And you see the same game, but with different characters. I'm dead. Doing different things because, again, it was not a Mario Brothers game. It just became a Mario Brothers game. It's like you read about those movies that, weren't. Oh, I guess you can jump on those turtles. That's good to know. They weren't like, oh, this turned into a Die Hard movie. It was originally, the script was something else, or the movie Cyborg with Jean-Claude Van Damme. Wasn't that originally Masters of the Universe 2 or something like that? Like, I'm not going down. I'm going to keep trying to go up. Whoa, baby. I don't know what that guy is throwing at me. Guys, if you're on an audio podcast right now and you're listening to this, I apologize. I'm trying to talk and make it as entertaining as it is. As it can be. But I have to tell you, for the people watching on video, it's not that much more entertaining. I just literally just jumped off myself. I am down to 2 lives and I gotta, don't drop me. Okay, there's a door. Get me to that effing door. Okay. Please. No, don't drop me there. I'm just gonna die. Okay, there's the door. Can I go through it? I cannot. There's a hoverboard. I'm gonna go for it. What? This game is over. I'm done with this game. I'm done. No more video game. That was it. Back to the Future 2 and 3. Now I look on Wikipedia and I like to see the reception. This is, you know, you go down and you look at video games. It talks about the history of it, maybe the plot of it. Here we see the reception. There's a couple paragraphs. I'm going to read these from the Wikipedia page. So it says, Skyler Miller of Allgame acknowledged Back to the Future Part 2 and 3 had little to do with the source material and had nonsensical elements. It was, quote unquote, a decent Super Mario Brothers ripoff with reasonably tight controls and passable graphics. Yeah, the controls, I mean, again, the controls were okay for me. GamePro also comparing the game to Super Mario Brothers, suggesting its various arcade-style minigame levels makes this cart as challenging and that they provide hours of fun. Really? GamePro was, again, were they trying to sell it? Stan Stepanek of GameFreaks365.com gave Back to the Future 2 and 3 positive remarks in regards to similarities with The Goonies 2. Remember that video game? Barely. I know what happened. I don't think I ever played it. I might have rented it once. Folks, when I was a kid, they rented video games and they rented movies and video games. So you would go to the video store and you could rent an NES game and have that for a couple days or a day or whatever. And it was way better than playing and than just buying games. because you could try different games for the week. And I feel like the video game stores were like, or the video game creators were like, what the hell? Anyway, he says he gave it largely negative review due to the lack of a password or save feature coupled with its notorious length, although there was a code to skip to the second half of the game. Really? Stepanik stated that it took him roughly 6 hours just to map to it, just to map it. And he spent so much time trying to finish it, he actually turned it off for boredom. Because apparently there's the part two is where we are at the beginning. Then part three, he travels, he receives a letter from Doc that was written in 1875. Weird, because it's 1885 in the film. According to the letter, Doc has become stranded, and Marty goes back to eight to save him, I guess. So we do get both elements. I wonder if part three's element is as shitty as part two. I would love to skip ahead for that, but I'm not going to do that to you. I'm not going to waste your time, the good, faithful listener. So I'm done. That's it. A double episode for your listening pleasure. I hope you have a wonderful Thursday. Now, listen to this. I am getting this episode up because tonight, Thursday night, I got this episode up early because Thursday night, tonight, I am recording over at Fine Movies, Fine Spirits. We are recording our own discussion on the original, the classic, my favorite movie of all time, Back to the Future. I wonder how it's going to go. I mean, it's you know, some guess what? We're all going to love it, and we're all going to talk about how much we love it. And if one person says anything negative about it, I'm going to kick that person off the show, and they're gone. So you listen, we're done here. You can find me on Twitter, Instagram, Threads, Mastodon.social, Blue Sky. I think that's it. At Geek Mentality, the Facebook page is fans.experts, the YouTube channel is fans.experts, and the website is fans.experts.com. Thank you so much for listening. Thank you so much for subscribing. Happy Thursday, everybody. I'll see you tomorrow. But until then, here is my theme song. This is my podcast. I made it. Geek Mentality is what I named it. And I think you should listen and subscribe. 'Cause I'm kinda funny and awesome. I think that I'm worth your time, and I'm kinda handsome. My mom says, please listen and please subscribe. At least listen to this episode.
Fans Not Experts.